Too loud? Loud enough? Go up a little more? Okay, all good. Good. I was a graduate of the University of Texas in Austin as a fine arts guy, and took no commercial classes, but fell into it. So I'm going to cover a bunch of things today, but mostly what I want to really emphasize is the practice of constantly drawing and sketching. So in the back I have my sketchbooks and a lot of loose things, which we're going to go back there at the end, if you haven't already done it, and go through them and look at them. I think a dialogue is better than a monologue, so really at any point in the conversation when I'm talking, if you have questions, just get my attention. I'll talk to you about that. And so I'm 61, so for 40 years, I have walked out the front door with a sketchbook in my hand. And it's just something that I've done for many, many reasons, to get ideas. I took photography under Gary Winogrand, but I sucked. I just was not a photographer. And drawing is really kind of my thing, and I consider it the nuts and bolts. It's the rebar of how everything gets developed. So I draw from life, I draw from photographs, I draw out of my head, I get friends to model, I've paid models, I appropriate, I draw after comic book guys, the whole nine yards. But the thing is just a constant practice of iteration, just drawing and drawing and drawing. So I'm going to show a few things, and this is going to be pretty low tech, because I'm better with a pencil than I am with many other things. So I will start here, and if this doesn't make you nauseous, just close your eyes. This is a drawing done in St. Mark's in Florida. So for 7 years now, I've been a representative for a pen and pencil company. And again, I fell into the commercial application of what I did, because I was typical in 1978 of a lot of people in the fine arts department. We walked right by the illustration department and kind of sniffed as we walked by, but because I drew and I have a figurative, kind of angle on things, I just fell into it. I fell into illustration work. And just constantly drawing and keeping a record of what I see and where things are. So this is a berm that heads to the Gulf of Mexico. There was actually a croc right down in the water below, and I quickly moved up the berm as he came up hit the bank. This is a drawing that I did in the circus of Baraboo, which is where Ringling Brothers has their, used to winter over. So it's just a quick brush pen drawing up at the top. It's where the tents hit, there's these stars, the tent, and this is just some bales of hay, under things. So some of the drawings that I do were very heavy with ballpoint line, I'm very linear. And 40 years ago, I stopped drawing in my sketchbooks with graphite charcoal because it just creates clouds of dust. And so I went to ink, largely ballpoint. But then in time, because I like the power of woodcuts, I just wanted something that covered more and went for big, heavier lines and stuff. So I started using and playing with a variety of different kind of brush pens and stuff like that. This is actually drawn from a train. This is drawn from Amtrak, traveling 40 miles an hour of strawberry fields. So these are these hooped plastic things with the strawberry plants in them, and in the distance you can see the haze. So I draw, oftentimes I go out the door, I'm pretty geeked out. I have a lot of stuff on me, I wear a vest for that reason, so when I sit on a train or airplane or whatnot, I have my palette right in front of me. I can pull stuff out and work. So I use big brush nibs and small stuff. I use a variety of grays and blues so that I can capture things. For example, right up here in the back, you're getting the sense of the haze, really light gray, just knocking that in. And then trying to see rhythm, like looking for rhythm in nature to help me describe things. So these things are set up with these series of hopes, and then at a certain point, I start seeing this kind of like pattern like this, go back as you see. We all know when we go by cornfields, you see these patterns. So while I did draw very photorealistically and naturalistically, I also steal from a lot of different ways of looking. I have a pantheon of gods. There's no one or two or five people that I revere. It's a huge number. It's pan-cultural. It's a Katie Colwitz and Daga and Ong, all the typical ones, but then it's a lot of comic guys and Jim Nutt and a variety of different stuff and Tomorrow, Yoshitoshi, Hiroshi, etc., etc. There's a lot of Persian miniatures. And just looking to see how they capture life and movement and various things like that. What? So,
How about Kim Jong-il? Ever forget his stuff?
Who's that?
Kim Jong-il.
I've seen a little bit of it. I mean, there's just nobody I haven't like embraced. I look at all of it. I mean, it's about, because I think one of the things I make a point of when you're drawing, especially those of us that do portraits, you're drawing two portraits at one time, always. You're drawing the observed, and you're making a comment about the observer. So when we look at Lucian Freud's paintings, we see Lucian Freud in his paintings, even though he's painting those figures laying on the bed. We see de Gaulle when he does the painters. So I've always tried to find, as I've been drawing, my handwriting. I tried to see what is my handwriting. You know, what part of me leaches out through the tool. And so looking at other people and seeing their personality come out and the way they use the tool has always been something I have looked to find in my own body of work. Trains, I'm on them a lot. And so I tend to use stuff that doesn't stink, because I don't want to get asked to stop. I'm going to be in subways drawing, I'm on trains, I'm buildings. I've tried to draw stuff that, let me see if I can go the right way here. I've tried to draw stuff that was difficult for me. Because for a long time I didn't draw nature. I just drew these claustrophobic little images of kind of punk stuff. Let me see if I can find some of that, like this. So this is from about, this is from about 20 some years ago. You know, I went from being real photorealistically to just trashing that whole concept and going real punk and nutty and comic book and what's called two Tijuana Bibles, bluesies, real anarchistic and real political and polemical and spilling personal ideas out into the work, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So this is an intaglio. Again, the intaglios just give you this punchy line that you can barely get anywhere else, and so I love working in it. At that time I was sketching a lot in ballpoint, so this kind of took the linear work one step further for me. And you know, I did use appropriation. I would use figures like Dagwood and Bumstead, and this is sort of a Dick Tracy-esque figure, right? Flathead, and this is Junior. Because they have a prehistory, so it was a narrative element I could include right into my story. I could basically take something, somebody knew something about their character. They were bumbling, they were confident, they were this or that, and I slide them into the image and use it that way, and then try to appropriate other techniques. There's dot patterns in here that you can't see. So I used a lot of chart pack, remember that stuff? With the glue on one side and the dots, and you cut that stuff out. I have done prints using that, whole prints using that stuff, which is, yes, it does address the fact that I have a little OCD, but, you know. And then some of the work got really rough, really violent, because it was about politics and stuff. And this was during when I was a young guy and just got married, and we couldn't afford a house. The housing markets were going up and up and up, and we just thought, we'll never be able to afford a house. And then they crashed. And so, I mean, we're talking 25, 26 years ago already. And I lived in Austin, Texas, which saw booms and busts in the economy. So I pull a lot of personal dynamics and cultural dynamics into my work. For me, it's the soapbox, it's how I have therapy. It's where I go delve down into there and I air things. Now sometimes Picasso says, when I draw, I'm showing you what I discovered. But for me, the body of work that I've done over the years has been a searching thing. Because many times it's I do something in image, it doesn't mean I'm resolved about my philosophy of life. It's part of the step after step of me trying to resolve things and figure things out. So I'm thinking out loud and I'm expressing angst and whatnot. So this figure right here is, you know, kind of Jigs, one of the Family Guys. And he's doing this really vulgar thing, which it comes from a pension novel about bureaucrats who shit red ink, right? And he called them cagatintas. This title is called Cagatinteros, right? And these are the traders that are classic of 1920, when the collapse of the economy, they're hanging themselves. Poor and rich alike were affected by downturns in economies, and this guy is just on the housing market is just red ink. And lo and behold, that comes back up again and again. And 8 years ago, we had yet another one. So I really encourage people to spill your feelings out into your work and your sketchbooks, because you have this innate sense of the world. And it's in the books sometimes that you realize you said things, you articulated stuff that you feel that come to be later on. Don and I met at the Palette and Chisel, where I still maintain a practice of going and drawing from the figures. And again, drawing with various techniques, sometimes I just do what's called either or. I'm just gonna get something that's light or dark with brushwork, and these are full figures, but this is just a section of the guy lifting the model up. And my sketchbooks try to kind of expand and explore what I play with in the sketchbooks. And one of the things that I tell a lot of students is that I bring my sketchbooks for the specific reason for you to see failure. Because over and over and over again, I articulate failure, which is just you reaching beyond where you're capable at that time, you know? And taking chances and having risks and practicing things in the books that later on will come out to be in another way. Because as I troll back through the books, I see stuff. I'll see things repeat. And so you can see the way that you're thinking, well, you may not be aware of it. Why is this image constantly repeating? That kind of thing. This is a scratchboard drawing. It's done on laminated plastic, black over white, micro-thin layers. So I try to use a lot of, nothing about me is radical. I'm a pretty traditional guy the way I draw and stuff like that. But I do try to use odd materials and unorthodox materials. So I was drawing with children's scratch paper at one point. Dick Blip made this really cheap little children's scratch paper over in black over the stuff, and you had a wood stylus. And then I was in a bank one day, and I was standing there, and there was this wood grain sign with white lettering that said, please wait here till the next available teller. And the letters were deep. I could see the letters were in there. They were white and like that. And I looked around, and I took my penknife out, and I went, and there was a little white line, and I went, so I went to the sign store and I said, you know those signs cops are wearing on their labels, white letter on that? He said, yeah, we sell that here. I said, can I get some blanks? He said, well, what do you want written on it? I said, I don't want anything on it. I just want blanks. And this stuff is like black over white, red over white. You can see it in stairwells, used as stairwells in case of a fire. And wood grain over. So I take razor blades and rifflers and Dremels and stuff, and I scratch off the black, and I have the white, which is in a way is kind of interesting because you're drawing with light. You're articulating the image by introducing the light into the image. And this is a head about yay big, and it's part of a figure that I did from a friend of mine who is a Mexican-American from San Antonio, but is into crazy Buddhism stuff. So he's got Day of the Dead figures, but he's also got Buddhist tantric imagery on him. So melding a lot of different things. The same way when I draw, I try to meld naturalism and comic book, Daumier with, Wyatt even. And I'm a guy that actually likes, I've liked Norman Rockwell, but when I went to school, you were not supposed to mention that name. you weren't supposed to talk about those guys you like. But again, he does so many things that I do enjoy, and his shoes are something that I really like because they fit on those feet. And he drew every pair of shoe that was out there. But when I'm on the train drawing, if I'm up against people and they're crowding me like this, then I just look down and I just start drawing the array of shoes. And on one car, I'll have 40 people and not two people are wearing the same identical pair of shoes. It would have driven Norman crazy. But I also talk about Norman. He wanted to show people their best attributes, largely speaking. So that was his take. And so I'm the left hand. I'm Norman's left hand. I show the part of humanity that Norman doesn't address so much, and hence the guy over the barrel. I also did illustration work. I fell into illustration work and worked for Andante, which is a classical record company. And I'm not the best portrait guy walking down the planet, so I figured, what the heck, I'll get paid to practice drawing people. And I think there's somewhere around here, there might be another one of those guys. But yeah, here he is, Dvorak. Get him out here where you can see him. So I was also using the materials as part of the text, so I would draw on paper, you know, composer's paper, do the drawings of the ballpoints and various things like that. And the designer was the designer for L initially, and when he saw my sketchbooks, he said, just keep drawing like this, just do this. We'll photograph the images out of your sketchbooks. So I think Don circled my resume, talked about what I did as another classical guy, Webern. I did Playboy, ECFO Bank, business magazines for 2.5 years. I was the illustrator for the Classical Record Company, which is a French company. I worked for Faber-Castell now for 7 years. I've been there, one of their geeks. I got every single one of my illustration jobs, every single one, because of my sketchbooks. I never took a glossy portfolio with finished works before anybody. I met Carrick Pope in his office because Tony Fitzpatrick dragged me up there one day when I was visiting Chicago. He said, hey, get your sketchbook, come with me. So he goes up there to Carrick Pope's office, which is what illustrators would kill to walk in there with this guy with your little thing, with your finished work. All I had on me was a sketchbook. And to my surprise, he went through that book and he didn't go, you're great, kid. He went through the book and he looked at it and he would flip the pages and he would ask questions. And then he gave me a job. He called me a week later and he gave me a job, a page and a half spread on the issue that Anna Nicole Smith is the Playmate of the Year, illustrating an Ethan Coen short story. Because in a sketchbook, they can see you think. Drawing is thinking. They can see if you take chances in your sketchbooks. They see if you change materials. They see if you draw naturalistically. They see if you draw funky. They see what you draw when nobody's looking over your shoulder. And that's why I bring my sketchbooks, so you can see what I think and the variety of ways that I can solve things and get stuff up on the page. I worked at the comic convention in Minneapolis. I've done that a bunch of years. And so as people walk around, they stop and I do quick demonstration sketches. This is Harley Quinn. She was walking with Poison Ivy. So I had to do a demo in a tent. And so I got them to come sit down for me and do this little, real quick 10-minute knockout, you know, of Harley Quinn and some of the other ones. I don't draw I can draw in pencils, but I just don't. I draw in ink because I wanted to force my hand. I really wanted to see the mistakes. So Degas talks about the concept of pentimenti, which literally in Latin means five minds. So pentimenti, when you see Degas' model and she's like this and you see the second series of arms because she's tired or he didn't think his first assessment was correct. I like that. And that's the way I work. Even on finished illustrations many times, you can see me change things. I like leaving that evident. So if there are no marks on the page, they aren't there. This was just drawn in quick ink, and then again by working with a couple of different tones on kind of a nice tinted paper, I'd sweep that stuff in, and if the paper has sizing on it, the ink doesn't go in right away, it lays there for a moment, and so then I can go like that. I'll literally show you demonstrations back there on the sketchbooks. I'll draw here and I'll sweep into the light. I'll draw the core shadow and I'll sweep in. You can see some of that evident. Then the whites on here are done with a grease pencil. The clunky white China marker. And I use it for exactly that reason, because it's a clunky, weird tool. I had great eyesight as a young man. If it was printed, I could see it. I could get in there and look at the dot patterns on Tintin's face and realize what the percentage of magenta, blue, and yellow were. But, you know, when I hit my mid-40s, I started reading books like this, and then I was reading with my left eye, so I had to kind of break down and get 2.5s, which is all I'll ever wear. I will not wear prescription glasses. If you want to know why, I'll tell you why. But anyways, so what now for me is that there's a lot of glare and haze on light, and the grease pencil emulates that. So when I'm drawing, I'm trying to actually articulate experiential things that I experience and feel, so glare is one of them. And so when I draw with the grease pencil, it doesn't give me the same crisp line that a fountain pen does, and I'll use fountain pens because the line stays wet, and then I can come back and I can me see if I can find. This is a gentleman that Don and I have drawn a million times. I bet you all have drawn DeLon here a few times. Again, sweeping in a lot of different stuff right here, doing that. Using brush nibs. So as I'm doing a brush nib, I simply do pop, 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 pop as I'm doing my line. And it just creates these dreads. Again, trying to see what is the character of the tool and how does the tool help me get a range of marks and features. I'm going to find one here in a minute that has the, I'll get up and see if I've got one, anything on here that you can see. So this gentleman, again, it's all just, it's ballpoint and gel ballpoints and pit pens and brush pens and stuff like that. He was a model that he hadn't modeled before. And he came to model and he stood there on the platform and we started off with the two-minute stuff and whatnot. And so he said, okay, that's good. And then he did this, he said, okay, next. And he did this, and he worked this way all the way around, which actually I think is interesting, right? Because when I have models modeled, I'll anchor the right leg. And the model has to do this, and then that, and then this, and our drawings will all kind of flow out of that one leg, and then when they move, you know, then the next drawing comes off of that. So I'll connect things, rather than all of the poses being radically different. But he was taking it to the extreme. And so this is a fully drawing I did of him blown up real close, just to give you a sense of how it lurks. For example, if I'm doing bop, bop, bop with a pen, and then I go bang, 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 like that, five marks becomes 10, 15, 20. So I don't draw fast. This is one of the points I want to make. Some people think, wow, you caught that in this much time, you're fast. It's not about fast. It's not about that. This was drawn on the subway. You can draw people sleeping, you can draw from the side, but drawing them straight on is the real challenge, right? So she's sitting across me, and I'm just sitting there drawing her. Tone paper takes care of the two value. So one is one, two, three, four, five. So if you break it down into five values, your paper, if it's toned, it's already got the two taken care of, and you're just gonna pop highlights and go dark, right? Pretty minimal drawing on her, using the paper to actually define features, like for example, the edge of her lip as it rolls away, the paper's got that covered. I'm just gonna you know, do parentheses on each side with the glare of light on it. So that's the point is by using a couple different tools and manipulating the tool and using the paper, it's about drawing efficiently, not speed. You know, so that's one of the things that I've tried to do because when you're in public and you're drawing. You know, you don't know when they're going to move, and it's been my understanding. If they move, I gotta contend with it. Let me see if I can find another example. Okay, so in Chicago we have the Ladies Roller Derby League, and this was drawn from a balcony, looking down on a friend of mine who's Anita Beer, and then some of the other ones as they pull over. So they're just getting a breather. She's about 5 minutes or 6 minutes. And again, you know, brush nibs, sweeping stuff in real quick. One of the things you might notice, if I can find an image that's a little more descriptive, is that I tend to do a lot of cross contour, and I draw with the. Well, that's not sharp. Let's see. I draw with the form. It's one of the things that I want to make evident if I can. Okay, here's this guy. Let me just get him up a little bigger. There we go. Come on. All right. So, for example, cross contour is going to roll with the form and go up and against and cross. So, the whole time I'm making the mark has to say something. The mark has to describe volume, texture has to tell me something about it. So, when I'm drawing on his scarf, I'm getting the more ink on my finger and I'm just dabbing like that so it creates a weave. The fingerprints create weaves, they create 5 o'clock shadows. You know, I use that texture again as an efficient way to kind of quickly develop the surface and the information on him. So, and then the back, rather than be real expressive, I try to do monodirectional walls, movement, things like that. Let me see if I can find. She sat down, she was the, she ran the desk at night at a hotel I was staying at in Minneapolis. She agreed to read a sketchbook of mine and just sit there while I drew her. So I don't get too mathematical about perspective. I just get the layout of where I am relative, right? Light source is important to me. When I draw, I always try to indicate in that drawing where the light source is. I'm always mindful of where that is on there. Otherwise, you know, I'm using brushwork the same way that you got patterns and stuff like that to kind of give me information on her. Just following the form and then switching out. So I think that there's more to her dress down below. It's a little bit more in the drawing. It's cut off. I think that I drew that in under an hour. I think she sat there for me. Cafes. I spent a lot of time in cafes. And again, notice that the books have a lot of ambient marks in them. It's like I don't mind that. If the page has got an opening in it, and I just right there, I just jump into it and let things overlap. Again, directional mark makings. It's just as if you're running your hand over somebody. That's kind of the way I'm reinforcing the shoulder on him. I'll just throw up a bunch of quick ones. Again, if you're working with a brush nib, then in one shot, you just do the whole stripe. And again, this is done with like a pen tail, something like that. I see lots and lots and lots of this. And this is one of the things that I talk about drawing, because I see so much of this. Right, my chiropractors are always mentioning that, you know, you get a lot of work because we're all doing this to ourselves. And that literally, when you go out and draw, what you're doing is you're doing this. And you're engaging the world. So when I travel the country, the first time I traveled, and I told the corporation I worked for, I said, look, stop flying me to these joints and airplanes and fly me back. Put me on a bus and let me travel the country, and I'll draw and document the whole trip. This is some of the thing that you know, I want to hopefully touch quickly. You're visually literate. Don't take it for granted that everybody else is. This is one of the things that they teach and we work on here, is visual intellect and visual literacy. I work for a corporation that makes pens and pencils, art materials, but I'm an end user. I'm actually the person that uses this stuff. You would be shocked what they don't understand about the product they make, or how to use it, or how to promote it. So, and working for a corporation, I had to tell them things about their videos. They said, what do you think about this video? And they show the person drawing, and they're drawing like this, and you can't see what they're drawing because the camera's right-handed person's over their right shoulder. So I had to break it down and say at 423 in the video, what you've done is you've blocked, I can't see where the rubber meets the road. And they go, oh. And then, you know, your skill sets that you're learning here, you will be surprised how widely you can apply them. I would have thought you would have been nuts if you told me I'd be working for a corporation as a pencil geek selling pencils. I did illustration work. I never thought I would have done that. I worked for a record company. You know, I've worked for physicists articulating some of their concepts. There's a lot of things that we do. You can go work for Ford Motor Company. Those of you that study anatomy, right? Why did we get carpal tunnel syndrome? Because they didn't realize there are 8 bones in there through which a lot of stuff has to travel and get around. They don't want to study anatomy in a lot of places, in a lot of art schools. I came from UT, they bought off a bunch of the painters, they got rid of ceramics, they don't believe in handcraft. But when I travel around to RISD and SCAD and a lot of other places, they're bringing in truckloads of Asian students. And they can draw, because in Asia they still revere this thing. And we hopefully still have a foot in that world that reveres this, right? That's part of what drawing for me is about, is integrating how I explore the world. You know, for me, it's real important to do that. And going out and engaging. So some people who are shy to go out and draw in public, I'm telling you, not a one of them was aware of it, me drawing. They are oblivious. Now, occasionally you get somebody who is keen, they can pay attention because, you know, so there's ways that I draw in public. One is I wear a baseball hat, so if I'm sitting with the sketchbook on my lap and I'm drawing like this, the peripheral vision, everybody can see the bird drinking from the well and they look over at me. So I put my nose between the page, I bring the page up, I bring my nose between the page and the subject, and then all I'm doing is I'm just raising my eyes up and down. And as I'm looking at the page, I can still see the field. As I'm looking at the field, I still have my place on the page. So it's a more fluid kind of movement. You're also not having perspective issues of this plane, something like that, so you get things up a little bit like that. And it keeps you quiet. So when I'm looking down as I'm drawing, I can tell that somebody's looking at me. And if they do, then I look off, and I draw the sleeve in, and then I can see they look away, then I just go right back in and I get it, you know? This is my job, to go out and capture stuff. And as a result, it's meant that I've gotten to work in court. Because I already had the practice of drawing people, you know, while they were doing stuff. And some of the courtroom drawers I've seen, there's a one in Chicago who will go nameless, he draws on tracing paper. Because if he bollocks this part of the drawing, he can trace it onto a finished drawing. So he's always drawing all these little bits and pieces, and then he tries to kind of make them into an image of the court for the cameras to see. But I put everything right on the page. And again, when we sat down and I watched him draw, he was like, wow, wow, he was like looping that stuff and going like this. And I'm very methodical in the way I lay things out, and I see stuff, and I capture foreground, background, because I have, a lot of ways to kind of build the drawing up. This is done during the break, right? So you're prioritizing when you draw. This is most important. What's most important? So whether I'm drawing a sketch, thumbnail, finished drawing, illustration, I ask the exact same question for every single drawing I've ever done in my life, and that is, what am I doing? Once I establish what I'm doing, the editing process kicks in, and I know what I don't have to do. So I can focus on the stuff that's relevant and tells the narrative and tells the story about what's before me. And again, planar development helps build stuff rather than expressive, kind of, you know, all over the place stuff. So I'm a little more strategic, I guess, is the way I could say it. A couple friends of mine go to the racetrack and to draw the ponies in New York. They like to gamble, so I went with them. And they're sitting down going to the forms, and I see a guy. I'm going to go draw this old geezer, so I get over to the geezer. I see if I can draw him. As soon as I sit down, he gets up and he walks away. So I turn around, and there they are, sitting there on this low bench, where you, like, basically nothing below them, right? And we're all, you know, they're all putting on weight, we're getting on there. And they look like those Ukrainian eggs that there's a figure painted inside of a figure painted. So then I very quickly get them, and again, line weight, background, fingerprints, make trees, just a variety of quick ways to kind of get this thing to develop. Next image is of them. In the racetrack. So even in sketchbooks, I still think in terms of layout and design. And I love triangles. I absolutely triangles. I cut corners a lot, so Fred and Rob are there catching in a hazy summer day. So edge induction. That which is close, clear, and you can see sharp, you draw it that way. As things go away and you lose that sense of that crisp edge, you drop the edge out and you start doing things softer so that you can create depth, and you also focus kind of where you want the viewer to really look the most at. It's getting about 10 after, and I'm not sure if this is the best way to go through them or if this is the best way to go through them, but this could make you nauseous. But we'll go through some stuff this way and see if this live jazz concerts. This is in the State Fair in Minneapolis. So quickly, I'm drawing this stuff because it's stable. The stable and dynamic elements, right? So I'm drawing this because it's stable. Once I get this laid out, then I can, underneath it, I'll know where things will fit. I have the balcony here, and then one person steps there long enough for me to do this. These guys, so I got background, foreground, and then I start layering in between the figures that are underneath the booth, they're just black silhouettes. So that's, and then the trees, again, fingerprints, smudging, sweeping, stamping, a variety of different grays. Using a variety of different grays, cool and warm, help you get into really dense areas, and it will allow you to, you know, show what might, you separate elements. So if everything being the same number two pencil, you have a variety of different things. Again, this is just a brush nib and landscape stuff. This is at Alana Baseball Park. And even on this one right here, as I'm drawing down there on my sketchbook, I was dropping the peanuts on the sketchbook. So I drew the peanuts on the, so it's a kind of a conceptual drawing, which one minute it looks like as if you're looking at a ballpark. The next minute you have these floating peanut shells. And this was on a ledger book. They have a lot of sizing in them. I'll show a few more images. And then if you want, we can go to the back and I'll make marks. You ask questions. So let me just burn through some of this stuff real quick, right? And see if I can find anything. I never used to draw architecture. Now I'm out there capturing that. That's under 8 minutes. Okay, brushwork, big brush nibs help you knock that stuff in. He was not happy with his lawyer, so he called him over, and you know you don't have much time when he's giving him an earful. So you gotta bang it out, you gotta really get it out. And then drawing in public is what gets that editing process up where you know what's important. He was sitting right across from me, talking to somebody else. This is Larry Paulson. He used to go to school here. Fantastic artist. This is a drawing from about 25 years ago when I first started drawing with brush nibs. I just love the way that they give you just so much character. You know, and they're very fast. This was probably a Statler or a Tombow. You know, nice and wet. Unfortunately, it's not waterproof. So let's go back and look at the sketchbooks. And then you can ask me questions, right? And I can tell you what I can. Thanks.